Towering high over old London town is a famous clock called Big Ben. It has been chiming the hour for many, many years, telling the people of London that it's time to get up, go to work, or calling them home for supper. Supper. Food. Now, food is something that most of us take for granted. I suppose that's because most of us have plenty to eat. But sometimes we fail to give a thought to those who are less fortunate. Well, on this particular night, a long time ago, as the crowds hurried through the streets of London, few of them gave any thought to those poor unfortunates to whom the sound of Big Ben's chiming the supper hour was but a hollow mockery. Among the poorest of the poor was a very small little boy named Oliver Twist. At least that's the name he was given by Mr. Bumble, who was the master of the workhouse where Oliver lived. Being an orphan, Oliver was a public charge. Now, the workhouse children in those days were treated very badly. They labored hard from early morning till late at night and received only one meal a day, consisting of a very small piece of bread and one spoonful of oatmeal, except on Sunday, when, in addition, they were given a tiny, undernourished onion. Now, as you can well imagine, this was hardly more than slow starvation. Why, those poor children had less to eat than you feed your dog or cat or even your pet canary. So one night, the children had a meeting and decided that something had to be done about obtaining more food. When supper time came, as they were receiving their single spoon of oatmeal, one of the boys sitting near Oliver leaned over and spoke to him in a whisper.
Oliver! Oliver!
What is it?
Now's your chance. Go ahead. Ask him.
I don't think I'd better. Why can't someone else do it?
We had all that decided at the meeting. You're the smallest. You look more starved than any of us. He might feel sorry for you. If it does, we'll all profit by it. Go on now. Go on. Ask him.
Here, now, what's all this? Ain't natural for one to be so quiet all of a sudden. And who's this getting up from the table? Why, it's Oliver Twist. Spoon and bowl in hand. Now, what do you suppose he wants?
Will me fine little workhouse brat? And what do you think you're doing?
Please, Mr. Bumble, I want some more.
What was that?
Please, sir, I want some more.
You want some... Mrs. Mann! Mrs. Mann, I say!
Yes, sir, Mr. Bumble, yes, sir.
Did you hear what this boy said?
No, sir.
He said he wants some more. He asked for more food.
He didn't.
If this leaks out, the authorities will be down on my head. I knew no good would come of keeping him here. He ain't like the others. He's got too much spirit. But I'll break it. I'll break it if I have to throttle him with me bare hands.
Now, Mr. Bumble, remember your temper. You did anything like that, it would cause an awful scandal. No, the best thing would be to just get rid of him.
Eh? What was that? Get rid of him, is it? Mrs. Mann, you bit it. I'll get rid of him if I have to pay someone to take him off me hands. Want some more, does he? Take him away! Put him in a dark cell till I decide what's to be done with him.
Oh, no, sir, please don't do that. I'm afraid of the dark. Please, sir, don't put me in a cell. Please, sir, don't...
Take him away! Now, if any of you other workhouses want to ask for more...
The very next day, Mr. Bumble made a big sign which he personally tacked up on the wall outside the workhouse so that all who passed that way might know that a special award of £5... would be paid to anyone who would take Oliver Twist as an apprentice. Toward the middle of the day, two people were attracted by the sign and stopped to read it. One was a man. He had a long, straggly beard and was dressed in tattered clothes, ill-fitting and not very clean. The other was a boy, about 15 or so, but dressed more like a man of 20. The boy started to walk away, but the man stopped him.
One moment, Dawkins. £5, eh? interesting proposition.
Beg pardon, Governor?
Pay attention when Fagin talks.
Sorry, Governor. I was only looking at that prosperous bloke across the street. I thought
well,
maybe...
Well, don't. I'll do the thinking for all of us. Let's go inside and inquire about this Oliver Twist that the workhouse wants to be rid of to the tune of £5, huh? Sounds like a good bargain, Dawkins. And Fagin is always looking for a good bargain, huh?
Well, what do you want?
I beg your pardon, sir, but have I the honor of addressing the master of this most excellent workhouse?
That's right. Speak up.
Permit me, sir, to introduce myself. My name is Fagin. This is my associate, Jack Dawkins. Speak up, Dawkins.
Happy to know you, Governor.
Mr. Dawkins and I are engaged in the jewelry business. I come to inquire about this boy you wish apprentice. Oliver Twist, I believe his name is.
Ah, you want apprentice Oliver? Well, sit down, gentlemen. I'll have the boy brought at once. Mrs. Men.
Yes, Mr. Bumble.
Bring young Oliver. And mind you, treat him gently.
Yes, sir.
The jewellery business, you say?
Quite. I polish precious stones.
Interested. And you'd be needing a boy to help, eh?
Well, I wouldn't go so far as to say I need a boy, no. You see, I have quite a staff of boys. Quite a staff. But when I chanced upon the announcement outside, I thought perhaps if the workhouse could be prevailed upon to raise the amount to £10.
Huh? The amount is £5.
Seven?
Five.
£5, two?
Five, I said, not a shilling more. Take it or leave it.
I'll take it, sir. Yeah. After I've seen the boy, of course. He is not sickly, I suppose.
See for yourself. Here he is.
Hello, Oliver.
Hello.
He doesn't look too strong for a growing boy.
How much strength does it take to polish jewelry?
Yes, quite so, quite so. Well, Oliver, how would you like to come home with me, huh? Learn a fine trade, have many friends, huh?
Oh, I'd like that, sir. That is, unless... Would Mr. Bumble be there, too?
Oh, no, 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 no. If you come with me, Oliver, you'll probably never see Mr. Bumble again.
I'll come with you and thank you, sir.
What was that? That's right, Oliver. You go along with Mr. Fagin and be a good boy. I'll have the papers drawn at once.
Good, good. Not forgetting, of course, the small matter of £5.
You'll get your money. Oliver will be ready tonight. Good day, sir.
Good day. Come along, Dawkins.
Righto, Governor.
See you tonight, Oliver. Don't fall sick meantime. Good day. Good day.
Well, Oliver, we're to be rid of you at last, and our good riddance. Where's my snuff box? Mrs. Mann, you seen my silver snuff box?
No, sir.
Could have sworn I had it in me pocket along with me watch. Me watch? Hey, Mrs. Mann, me watch! It's gone! I've been robbed!
When Fagin returned to claim Oliver, Mr. Bumble questioned him about the disappearance of the watch and the snuff box, but of course Fagin professed to be innocent. He took Oliver and left in great haste. The following morning, when Jack Dawkins arrived at Fagin's house, the old man looked at him with murder in his eyes.
Well, where is it?
Where is it? Where's what, Governor?
Don't bandy words with me, you sniveling little...
No need to whip me, Governor. Is the watch and the snuff box... They'll bring a pretty penny, eh, Governor?
You might have given the whole show away. Can't you learn to steal only when I say so?
Sorry, Governor.
Get Oliver up. There's work to be done.
We must begin his instructions.
In polishing precious stone,
Hold
eh,
your
Governor?
Tongue. Where's Nancy? Sykes, can't anyone get here in time?
Please, sir, were you asking for me, Mr. Fagin?
Well. Good morning. Oliver, you slept well, I trust.
Oh, yes, sir. It was the best night's sleep I've had since I was born.
Good, good. And now you'd like some breakfast, I suppose.
Breakfast? What's that, sir?
What's that? Why, it's breakfast, my boy. Food we eat in the morning.
You mean, sir, You eat twice a day?
In this house, Oliver, we have plenty to eat. But we also work hard to get it.
Huh? Oh, I don't mind working hard, sir. I'm used to that.
Excellent, my boy. In that case, I suppose we start once, huh? We have a little game we play with the new boys. The Dodger here will show you how it goes.
The Dodger?
I forgot. That's Jack Dawkins. We call him the Artful Dodger. It's a kind of nickname.
Artful Dodger? Why is he called that, sir?
You'll learn in due time, my boy. In due time. Now for the game. Now, let's pretend that I'm a very wealthy, well-dressed man. I'm standing in this street with nothing particular on my mind. In my pocket is a beautiful timepiece. A lovely watch, eh, Oliver? You paying attention?
Oh, yes, sir.
Now, the Dodger, he will try to take the watch out of my pocket without my knowledge, of course. And if his hand should slip and I feel it on my coat, I cry out, grab him by the hand.
What happens then, sir?
What happens then? Why, he loses the game, Oliver. Yeah. He certainly loses the game. All right, Dawkins, give Oliver his first lesson.
All that day and the next, and the day after that, Oliver was instructed in this new game. Sometimes the object sought was a watch, sometimes a silk kerchief, more often a pocketbook filled with money, and Oliver, who up till now didn't realize the purpose of the game, thought it was great fun. Finally, the big day arrived. All of Fagin's helpers and associates were there. Oliver was introduced to them.
Can't you keep that animal quiet, Sykes?
Who owns your horses? Lay down, you do! Be quiet! That'll hold you. All right, Fagin, let's get on with it.
Oliver, this is Bill Sykes. You're not clever enough to help him with his work yet, but you will be someday.
How do you do, Mr. Sykes, sir?
Are you sure he's to be trusted, Fagin?
Oliver's a grand boy. He's going to make a fine member of our little family, aren't you, Oliver?
Oh, yes, sir. I'll try very hard, sir.
And this, Oliver, is Nancy. Nothing like a woman about the house, eh, Nancy?
Oh, shut up, you driveling old fool. Come on. Come on, let's see if the child knows anything.
Dear Nancy, such a nice girl. So gentle, so refined. Very well, now to business. Oliver, you've learned the game well. Now you shall have a chance to play it for keeps. Pay attention to the Dodger. Watch everything he does carefully.
Yes, sir.
All right, out with you. The streets of London are waiting.
Isn't it a beautiful day?
Oh, it's a lovely day. So many people with nothing to think about.
Look, Jack, it's a monkey and a hurdy-gurdy man.
Don't waste your time on him. You couldn't get more than a few pennies. Hold up, Arthur Moe, Oliver. This is it. You see that prosperous old gent standing over there?
Where?
By the bookstore. Look sharp.
Oh, yes, I see him.
Well, then watch the Dodger with an eagle eye. I'm going over to him and try to get his pocketbook without his knowledge.
Like the game we play at home.
That's right, Oliver.
But I've never seen him before. Is he one of our family?
Is he one of our... No, of course not, you stupid bloke. This time we play the game for keeps.
But Dawkins, isn't that stealing?
What did you say?
I remember once in the workhouse, one of the boys took something from Mr. Bumble. They said it was stealing. He was put in prison.
Don't say that word. Don't even think it. Now look sharp, because the next time you'll have to do it yourself. Stand right here and don't make a sound. But watch everything I do.
But that's stealing. And stealing isn't right. Oh, dear. It wasn't a game at all. He's going to steal the man's money. I mustn't let that happen. It's almost there. What can I do? Sir, oh, sir, look out!
Eh? Here, what's all this?
Shut up, Oliver, you fool!
Here, now, here, my money! It's gone! Stop thief!
Oh dear, they're coming this way. I can't stand here. I'll be caught.
Oh, it is now, you little brat. I got you.
Oh, no, officer. It wasn't me. I didn't do it. Really, I didn't.
Now, we'll see about that. Come along now.
Where are we going, sir?
To the court, of course. What do you think we do with little thieves like you? Present you to Her Majesty. You'll spend the next few years in prison. That'll teach you.
The sound of Big Ben's chimes rang out as the police officer took Oliver to court, where he was charged with theft. But just then...
Stop! Stop, I say! This is not the boy. Your Honor, I am Mr. Brownlow. It was my pocket that was rifled. I saw the boy who did it, and this is not the one. As a matter of fact, this boy was standing across the street and cried out a warning. Otherwise, I should never have missed the money until it was too late. If Your Honor will permit, I shall be pleased to take the custody of this boy. I want to find out something more about him.
So Oliver was taken home by Mr. Brownlow. After a bath and some hot food, the kind gentleman sat down with Oliver and began to question him.
Tell me, Oliver, where were you born?
I don't know, sir.
Your first recollection is of the workhouse?
Yes, sir.
Strange. There's something about you. Come over here, Oliver. Look at this picture. Does it remind you of anyone?
Why, it looks a bit like me, sir.
You see it too, eh? Well, I was right. Oliver, haven't you ever been curious about your mother and father?
But I have no mother and father, sir.
Well, you once had, and unless I'm very mistaken, your father was Henry Claypole.
Henry Claypole?
He was a very rich man, Oliver, who died at sea. But he had a brother, your uncle, by the name of Noah Claypole, who inherited the fortune because no other heirs could be found.
I'm afraid I don't understand, sir.
Neither do I completely, Oliver, but we'll get to the bottom of it. We'll find out who you really are.
A few days later, Mr. Brownlow sent Oliver round to the bookshop with a sum of money to pay a bill. But just as the boy reached the neighborhood, he was surprised to hear someone calling.
Oliver! Oliver, wait a moment.
What is it?
Oliver, it's me, Nancy. Oh, Oliver, we've been so worried about you. Whatever happened?
Oh, I've had a terrible time, Miss Nancy. They caught me and said I stole the man's money. But they finally let me go.
Now, you're a clever child.
The man told them it wasn't me. Then he took me home and gave me food and new clothes. Now I have an errand to do for him.
Oh? What sort of an errand?
I have some money to pay to the bookstore. See?
Oh, my. My, that's a great deal of money for one so young as you to be walking about with alone. You know, I'd better go with you.
Oh, thank you, Miss Nancy.
Oh, not that way. I know a shortcut. Come on, follow me. All right, you little brat, get in here.
But, Miss Nancy, that's Fagin's house.
Right you are. In you go. Look, Fagin, see what I found wandering in the street.
Well, 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 if it isn't our dear little friend Oliver. Oliver, my boy, where have you been, huh? We were so worried about you.
Now, I can tell you, that old bloke, the Dodger Jump, testified for Oliver. They didn't press the charge.
Now, isn't that interesting? Who was the kind gentleman, Oliver?
I'll never tell you. Never.
Oh, I think you will. Sykes. Sykes.
Well, what is it? Can't no one get no rest around here?
We have need of your services, Bill. Perhaps you can persuade Oliver that he shouldn't have any secrets from us.
What do you want to know, Fagin?
The name of the wealthy gentleman who befriended him, where he lives, and the best way to gain an entrance into his house.
All right, you little brat, you heard, Fagin. Speak up now, before I twist your arm off.
Yes.
And if that don't do it, I'll let the dog get a go at you.
Once again, poor Oliver was at the mercy of Fagin and his murderous thieves. They forced him to give them Mr. Brownlow's address and a plan of the house. They made it quite clear to Oliver that they were going to rob the kind man. Finally, Fagin, Bill Sykes, and the Dodger left the house, but Nancy remained with Oliver to see that he didn't escape.
Nancy?
Well, what is it?
Nancy, you're not like the others. You're kind and good. I know you are.
kind and good, am I? What gave you that idea?
I can see it in your face. You don't really belong with Fagin and Bill Sykes.
Well, maybe if things had been different, I'd... Oh, shut up and go to sleep. I don't like that kind of talk.
Nancy, help me and help yourself. Go to Mr. Brownlow. Tell him that Fagin and Sykes are going to rob his house. Then afterwards...
Then afterwards what? Either I get sent to prison for the rest of my life or... Do you know what Fagin would do to me if I peached on him?
He couldn't harm you. Not after they were caught.
And suppose they weren't caught? Do you think they're fools? Now go to sleep. Go on now and put those ideas out of your head. Why, they'd kill us both for even thinking about it.
A few nights later, Bill Sykes and Oliver set out for Mr. Brownlow's home. Sykes insisted that Oliver accompany him and assist in the robbery, for the only way to enter the house unobserved was through the coal chute, and Oliver, being small and thin, could easily squeeze through.
Blasted night. The wind's going through me like a cold knife blade. And that's the way I'll put the blade through you if you try any of your tricks.
Please, Mr. Sykes, you're hurting my
arm. Yeah, I'll do more than that if you try to wake the household. Now you know what to do. Be quick about it and no mistakes. Understand?
Yes, sir. I slipped through the coal chute, run upstairs, unlock the door, and lead you to the safe where he keeps the money.
Right. And one peep out of you and it'll be your last. Now, get on with it. Here's the coal chute. In you go. I'll be waiting for you to unlock the front door. Well?
It's all right, Mr. Sykes. I didn't make a sound. Come in.
An easy crib to crack if ever I seen it. Where's the money kept?
Over here. Follow me.
Right.
All right, Sykes, put up your hands. I have you covered.
Blimey, a trick. No, you don't.
Look out, he's armed.
Keep away, I'll blow you all to kingdom come. Hold your fire if you don't want to kill the boy.
Oliver!
I can't move, Mr. Brownlow. He's caught me around the neck.
Yeah, and that's where I mean to keep you till I'm out of here safe and sound. Try to trick Sykes, will you?
It wasn't Oliver, Bill. It was me.
Nancy, what are you doing here?
I came to warn Mr. Brownlow. You're done for, Bill Sykes. You'll never get out alive.
Cross me, will you? Well, me fine girl, it'll be the last time.
Oh, Nancy, she's hurt.
Now I'm getting out. Hey, the first one of you moves, I shoot the boy right in the head. Come on, Oliver, stay in front of me. If they shoot, it'll be you, get it.
Oh, no, Mr. Sykes.
Outside, quick. Stay in front of me. Don't try any more tricks.
Let the boy go, Sykes.
Fagin!
Let him go.
Oh, no, you don't!
Mr. Fagin, you've shot Mr. Sykes.
I couldn't let him hurt you, Oliver. I couldn't.
Oliver! Oliver!
Over here, Mr. Brownlow.
Who's that with you? Why, it's Fagin, and he's running away. Stop him, Constable! Constable!
Fagin was captured trying to escape, and both he and Jack Dawkins were put in prison to await trial. It was then that the true story of Oliver's parents was made known. His father was Henry Claypole. He was drowned at sea, leaving a fortune to his son, if his son could be found. If not, the money went to Oliver's uncle Noah, who was an evil man and wanted the money for himself. So he bribed Mr. Bumble to destroy the records of Oliver's birth and change the boy's name. Mr. Bumble freely admitted his guilt, and he too was placed in prison with the others. However, just before the time came to carry out the sentence on Fagin, the old man made a last request. He asked to see Oliver and speak to him.
Who is it?
It's me, Mr. Fagin. Oliver.
Oliver. Oh, Oliver. Come in, come
in. I can only stay a moment. Mr. Brownlow is waiting.
Oliver, I always treated you kindly. I gave you plenty to eat. You had a nice warm bed. You said so yourself, huh? And the best night's sleep you ever had. You remember saying that to old Fagin, don't you? You remember?
Yes, I remember.
Oliver, Oliver, they're going to hang me. Don't let them do it, Oliver. Speak to them. Speak a word for old Fagin. I saved your life, Oliver. Sykes would have killed you. Speak a word for me, Oliver, please.
I'm sorry, Mr. Fagin. I'd like to help you, but you must be punished for your crimes. You're worse than the others. Much worse. You made them do wrong. And for that, you must be punished.
Oliver, the time is up.
I'm coming, Mr. Brownlow. Goodbye, Mr. Fagin.
Oliver! Oliver, don't leave me. Oliver! They'll hang me, Oliver! Oh, speak a word for me, Oliver! It's your old friend, Fagin! Oliver!
And so Fagin was punished for his wrongdoings. Noah Claypole was arrested and stripped of his ill-gotten fortune, and it was given to Oliver, who grew up to be a fine young man, who ever afterwards tried to help those less fortunate than himself. The chimes of Big Ben still ring out in old London town, telling the world that as time goes by, those who do evil are punished for their crimes, and those who live uprightly with consideration and love for their fellow men are showered with health, happiness, and prosperity.